Good evening. You're watching The Digital Age, and I'm Jim Zirin. Last August, there was a denial of service attack on Twitter, the social network. Twitter was out of commission for much of the day, and Facebook was also affected. Who did it? Why? And how was it accomplished? We don't pretend to have all the answers. But one thing we do know, the internet has become a new battlefield populated by cyber criminals and warring parties battling for control of cyberspace. So our question tonight is, how come the attack on Twitter, and what are its implications for national security and for security over our vital infrastructure? And here to tell us about it is an expert. He is Don DeBolt. Don DeBolt is a director of threat research at CA, a leading internet security firm, and he is based in Washington. Now, Don, let's start with the basics.
Sure.
We hear a lot about cyber warfare, cyber crime, cyber terrorism. What's the difference?
Well, and basically, the commonality is cyber, right? Is the use of technology to facilitate a criminal act. And today, you know, we're here to talk about some malware and how malware was used in the act of attacking Twitter, and also how malware is used across the internet for, you know, criminal activity.
Now, who conducts these cyber attacks? Are they states? Are they individuals? Are they criminals? Who does it?
Well, it's hard to say. The web introduces a significant level of anonymity, so you know the actors behind these attacks is difficult to trace back. You know, potentially they're hacktivists, you know, that are promoting a nation's agenda. It could be state sponsored. But it's difficult to tell. Or it could be financially motivated, which is what we see typically in the majority of malware today. It's simply a commercial endeavor.
Now, Twitter was a denial of service attack. What is meant by denial of service attack?
Well, basically, through the use of electronic means, you're communicating with the service or computer on the other end, and you're blocking access by a variety of means. You can either completely flood the network with traffic such that the routers and the telecommunication lines just can't keep up, or you can send the application bogus information, information that might confuse the application and stop it from working.
So you're throwing a monkey wrench, in effect, into the cyber works.
Oh, absolutely.
And you mentioned malware. Mm-hmm. That's a new term. What is malware?
Well, malware is, again, short for malicious software. It takes many forms. It can be a virus, a Trojan. It can be a backdoor or a rootkit, which hides itself or hides itself from an anti-malware product. Today, you know, over the last few years, we've seen the onset of spyware, which searches your system for personal identifiable information, maybe captures your search history. And then also, we have adware, you know, creating pop-ups for the sole purposes of, you know, directing users and clicks to ads that would be turned for profit.
Now, you mentioned a Trojan. What is a Trojan?
Trojan is basically any software that appears to be one thing but actually takes different actions. So it's a broad term. It could be a Trojan downloader. So it's a small piece of code that searches the net and pulls down a malicious binary, you know, specifically crafted for performing action on your system that you didn't otherwise intend to have happen.
Now, can malware be spread through a social network like Twitter or Facebook?
Absolutely. Typically, what you'll see in a social network is that the attackers leverage the community that's created, and they leverage the trust that's created inherent in those communities, and they communicate links. Or, you know, using Twitter, you're subject to a finite number of characters that you can send in each Twitter message. What they use is a method to shorten the URL through services like tinyURL. Basically,
you better explain URL.
Oh, sure. URL is Universal Resource Locator. It is actually the string of text that you enter into the browser that takes you to the website. So www.cnn.com is the URL that takes you to CNN. When you,
or www.twitter.com
exactly
takes you to the Twitter homepage.
Exactly. And so what you have in the situation of Twitter or Facebook is where the user is presented with information. It might be a little message that says, hey, I have a cool video from you from last night. And that's very enticing, isn't it? And you might want to click on that. But what happens is when you go to that site, there it's a completely fabricated website for the sole purposes of getting you to click and install software. So that you're first prompted with a message that says, oh, well, you first need to install this codec so you can view the video. And as a result, you install the codec, but you're not installing a codec, you're installing malware.
So you become an innocent agent of the hacker, in effect.
Absolutely. You may not even know that it was installed. You may think, oh, well, this program was bogus. It doesn't work.
So give us a demonstration. You recently became interested in the subject chronic low-grade fever in adults.
Yes.
So using your computer, tell us what you did.
Certainly. I want to just walk you through this demonstration.
Yes, please.
And this is a demonstration of a benign search. And using common search engines today, you can create a search for common things. In this case, the search string used was chronic low-grade fever in adults. It's a very benign string, isn't it? But when you search for that string, you'll be presented with some pertinent links and sometimes not so pertinent. In this case, I'm going to click on persistent low-grade fever in adults. I mean, that looks like it's content right up my alley. I want to read this. So when I click on that link, though, I'm presented with a specially crafted website. It might be a hacked website where certain code is injected, or it might be a completely fabricated website. In this, we have a diagram of a singer with information about the actual content that we're interested in. And in this diagram, in this flow, we see that we're being actually redirected. So we go to one website thinking that we're going to go learn about chronic low-grade fevers, but we're actually, our surfing is then our computer is taken to another website. In this case, we're prompted with this screen here. This is a very common screen that is used to social engineer people into thinking their anti-malware or antivirus engine just kicked off and is now scanning their computer. At the end of the day, the objective of this is to, again, trick you into thinking that you have malware on your system, that your computer is automatically running a scan. And in this case, you'll continue to be prompted with warnings, trying to convince you to not leave this malware on your system. And so if you click on it, it'll actually run through a hoax scan and, again, prompts you to download this software to fix and clean up this software.
So you're trying to solve a problem, but in effect, you're creating one.
Yes. I mean, you're searching. You know, you could be searching for a recipe. You could be searching for any type of benign contact, but there's going to be some suspicious links in those search results. And those links are specifically crafted for pushing or promoting rogue security products or fake security products. And that's what we're seeing here, is when you download this binary and you actually run it, you double click on the exe and run and install the software, you're installing a fake antivirus product.
On your computer.
On your computer.
Which then can emanate out to other computers and be part of a denial of service attack.
In this case, what we're seeing with rogues is typically it's a for-fee install. So monetary gain is the objective of this. But this could be part of a blended threat, and that's what we're seeing today, where one type of malware is blended or combined with another type of malware. And in the case, it could very well be combined with a bot, which is a small program that can be controlled from a remote location, to undertake actions like a denial of service, as you described.
Let's move on to that. Mm-hmm. You mentioned a bot. That's another weapon in the arsenal, a botnet. What is a botnet?
Yes. A botnet is simply a large distribution of small computer code. And it in the past it was called a backdoor. And basically it runs on your computer very quietly. It's a very small program, and it allows people to connect to that computer and basically control your computer.
So it gives the hacker command and control over your computer.
Absolutely, completely.
Now, are there Other new weapons that have been invented that might be used to attack our critical infrastructure, like air traffic control or nuclear power plant control systems?
Mm-hmm. What we've seen over the course of the last few years, we haven't seen a lot of new malware technology come to bear. Viruses in themselves, the code that actually copies itself from file to file, the techniques and tactics used today aren't necessarily new, but they still are very effective. The malware today is very commercial. It has a lot of backing. It's very robust. It's scalable. It's modular. It basically reeks of professional organizations that are creating this software.
And by the way, malware can be purchased online, can it? Aren't they auctioning it off in a kind of malware eBay?
Yeah, absolutely. There is a marketplace for malware. Again, one person might create the Trojan downloader component, and so you might buy that from one merchant, and then another portion might be the Rogue Security product. You might buy that, and then you might buy or rent time on a botnet, because when you establish a botnet and have thousands of systems out there that are under your control, there's monetary value in the processing resources, the ability to conduct malicious activity anonymously. So there's a lot of value in the owning of a botnet.
So there's a rent a botnet business out there.
Oh, absolutely.
Let's move on to the attack on Twitter. Who did it?
It's hard to say. When you look at the information that's available out there, it was certainly to be a hacktivist type, politically motivated attack, targeting one Georgian-based blogger that had a presence on Twitter, Facebook, LiveJournal.
Now, when
and
you
Google
say
Blogspot.
Georgia, you mean the country Georgia?
Yes.
And wasn't the August attack on the first anniversary of the tension between Georgia and Russia and the,
yes,
and the invasion?
Mm-hmm. It very well could have been tied to that. What we see on the internet is today is a very open platform. Some might say it's a great equalizer. It allows a single voice to be heard on a grand scale. You don't need a newspaper to distribute a political message. And so what this is doing is it's empowering individuals that have a cause, and in this case, this was a cause that was anti-Georgian, and in the event they used a distributed denial service using these bots to attack the Georgian infrastructure.
Well, there was a Georgian blogger out there who was apparently a dissident, and he had a Twitter account, and it was that account that was the target of the attack, isn't that right?
That's correct. That's right.
But we don't really know exactly who did it or why they wanted to take him down. And now, how did they succeed in taking all of Twitter down just by attacking one client?
Well, that's interesting, because they used a distributed denial service attack to attack it using multiple computers. Now, when you look at the actual volumes of network traffic that were headed to Twitter, you find that the volume of traffic was actually low. So it could have been a programming error in Twitter that was manipulated by the attackers, such that they didn't have to totally overwhelm the service with raw traffic, but they used logic to confuse the potentially confuse the application, thus creating the outage. We saw that the impact to other Web 2.0 services out there was not as dramatic as Twitter, but Twitter certainly responded very quickly and dissipated or remediated the problem as efficiently as possible.
Well, Twitter was the most recent attack. Was the Russian military at all suspect, or the elements of the old KBG, or is that all just speculation?
Certainly the Georgian blogger believes so. But again, the power of the web provides a level of anonymity, and certainly the difficulties of tracking back across national borders. It presents a very time-consuming and expensive process to hack back or trace back to the original source.
Now, just to go back a few years, in June of 2007, the United States government accused China of cyber meddling. Where it hacked into actually a Pentagon network that serves the Office of the Secretary of Defense and shut that down.
Yes.
And Deputy Undersecretary for Defense Lawless told a House committee that Chinese capabilities in this area have evolved from defending networks from attack to offensive operations against adversary networks. Mm-hmm. So China is on the offensive. China, I think, later claimed that these were rogue citizens acting autonomously, but no one quite believed that. So this is a real threat to national security as well, isn't it?
It is. The offensive capabilities are there, but it's inherent in, you know, our government, our military, our private industry to build up the necessary resources to protect ourselves.
Now, hacker has kind of a bad connotation, so I put the term hacker in Google recently. How many hits do you think I received? What's your guess?
Probably, you know, 1.2 million.
113 million.
Okay.
Responses. Going down the list, one of the first ones was how to become a hacker. Mm-hmm. Can hackers be easily trained online?
Yes. Well, that's the power of the internet. There's so much information readily available and you know, at very low cost. You don't have to send yourself to the university to learn the intimate underworkings of technology because it's there on the internet.
I don't have to go to a camp in Pakistan. It's all out there on the net.
No. And so, which makes it, you know, much more easy to perform because the cost or investment isn't required to do that. And what you find on the internet, you know, obviously the term hacker has been around for a while. It's a romantic or sexy term used in the information security world. But the traditional term is one that breaks apart code and truly understands how things work. And so, you know, it can be used, you know, in the negative context as well.
So hacker could be a good guy, someone who looks for vulnerabilities, mm-hmm. such as yourself. Are you a hacker in a sense?
In a sense, yes.
Yeah.
You know, we're looking at malware on a daily basis, trying to understand what it's doing, how it works, obtain that intelligence, share that, you know, with our customers, build protections for our customers, and then also share that intelligence with the worldwide.
Or it could be a bad guy. You remember Jonathan James, the teenage cyber criminal who mm-hmm. Went to jail for cyber crime. He hacked into Bell South, the Miami-Dade school system, the Defense Threat Reduction Agency, a division of the Department of Defense. Mm-hmm. He used a sniffer that allowed him to intercept over 3,000 messages. Is he kind of an example of the new breed of cyber criminal?
I wouldn't call him an example of a new breed. He's certainly an example of a cyber criminal. Today's, you know, cyber criminal, I think, is much more organized, not sole individuals, you know, with an agenda. I think they're more organized and commercial in nature. And again, you, there's a wide gamut of cyber crime activities. It could be for you know, political gain. Again, it could be for financial gain. The majority of malware that we see used out there is targeting financial gain. In the past, when you created a virus, it was all about street cred. It was, oh, I did this. I was able to create a piece of code that copied itself to a million computers.
Bragging rights.
Absolutely.
Like Mark Zuckerberg, the founder of Facebook, hacked mm-hmm. into the Harvard network and when he was a student there. And
right.
Was very proud of it.
Mm-hmm. And you'll see this in the malware from just a few years ago. Malware, you know, worms that were very popular, like Blaster, Code Red, SQL Slammer. The creators of that malware didn't benefit from that at all. They brought down, you know, resources, caused a lot of financial damage just in time and effort to repair those computers, but they didn't benefit from that from a financial or politically, you know, they didn't gain politically. But what they did was they proved the efficiencies that can be gained through the use of malicious code for a specific agenda.
Now, just to touch on the national security implications, Secretary of Defense Gates recently said that the United States is under cyber attack all the time, every day.
Yes.
Now, is this a military problem or is it really a universal problem? The government uses the same internet protocols, the same software, mm-hmm. The same computers as the private sector.
I think it is very much a universal problem because Right now, we have various legislation that's trying to identify what needs to be fixed and fix that. The problem is the internet, as we know, is borderless. We don't have the oceans on both sides of the continent to help us define our borders on the internet. And as a result, we have to work within those that currently control that infrastructure. Today, I see that there's a role for the military to play, there's a role for government to play, and there's a role for private industry to play as well, an equal role.
And President Obama, who thinks our internet is a vital national security resource, has said he's going to appoint a cyber czar out of the White House to look into all these matters. But what the government could probably do is compel the software manufacturers such as Microsoft to improve security over software. I mean, the objective is to have the most secure software that is obtainable, isn't that right?
Yes. I mean, obviously, securing the code is one avenue, but there's many other avenues and needs to improve security across the internet within our country. The changes need to take place again on multiple fronts. One of the areas that I think we need to focus on is user awareness, because everyone that participates on the internet has a role and responsibility. And actually today, or this month, is Cyber Awareness Month, the month of October, and the U.S. CERT.
Cyber Awareness Month?
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
U.S. CERT is promoting user awareness to the problems. And a program like this is great to get the word out, because everyone has a role in protecting our infrastructure, because we're connected to it.
So if I'm offered an update by Microsoft, a security patch, something that will improve security, I should accept it.
Absolutely. I mean, so those are some of the basic fundamentals that are required to perform. And but that goes from the user, from the consumer or home user, to the corporations, and also to the government. If you look at the GAO reports of the security audits of various government agencies, some of the fundamentals of patching their systems, making sure their anti-malware programs are up to date, installed, using appropriate firewall rules, all of those things need to be performed.
Now, our government is also attacking terrorist websites, potentially, or foreign websites that where it thinks it's in the national interest. And we have that capability in the Pentagon, don't we?
That I can't speak to. I'm not sure what offensive capabilities are there.
If we have any sense, we're developing offensive capabilities as well. I mean, it stands to reason.
It does stand to reason that is there. Certainly, there's been reports of even malware being specifically developed by law enforcement agencies worldwide for the purposes of surveilling a suspect. So installing computer code on their system, listening on their microphone, capturing video from their video camera or their laptop. Those types of programs have been reported to be in development. But unfortunately, I don't have firsthand knowledge of that.
What intrigues me is that if the government requires the software manufacturers to upgrade their software to make it secure as secure can be, that's going to inhibit the government in attacking the software of the computers of the bad guys, isn't that right?
Potentially.
So there's that risk. I mean, it's almost equity or inequity.
Yes, but I don't foresee that there's any, there's no quick fix to this problem. Changes again have to come across the board, whether it's infrastructure, whether it's people training, or actually the technology improving the security code. One of the aspects that's exploited right now is that many people run their computers in super user mode or administrator mode. This is common practice in the Microsoft Windows world. And there's not really a separation of duties or separation of power on the computer, because everything runs with with administrative privileges. So if you double click on something, you install it, and it can take any action on the computer that the that the super user is allowed to do, which really empowers the malware to get a root hold in that system, a foothold in that system, and maintain control over that system today. So there are some fundamental changes that can be made in the system, and Microsoft has gone down the path of attempting to prove that with user access controls in Vista and Windows 7. The problem is the paradigm. Users and applications and software developers aren't necessarily used to that paradigm, and so adoption is a problem at this point.
Well, let's talk briefly about where we're headed. Obama wants to appoint a cyber czar. He hasn't done so yet. Mm-hmm. Do you think that's a good idea?
Absolutely. I mean, he has stepped up, and said that he believes in cybersecurity. He believes that it's at the critical national infrastructure.
When he ran for president, his own campaign network was hacked into, he said.
Yeah, absolutely. So everyone is potential victim, including, Obama and his campaign website. What's important is to step up and actually, decide on the cybersecurity advisor position. Empower that individual in such a way that it can influence policy and influence changes that are necessary across the board.
And we have to engage the private sector as well as the government in this effort to improve security, isn't that right?
Exactly.
Because they're essential because of their control over the financial system and the electrical grid and other parts of the critical infrastructure.
Yes. Right now you have in Congress is the Cybersecurity Act of 2009, and that's an attempt for the government to gain greater control over that national infrastructure. Actually, to protect it, you need to control it, right? However, I feel that this legislation, at a high level, is very strong-handed, and I think you need to take a balance between the military and the government taking control and empowering the private industry as well. It needs to be a team effort. If you look, you look at our government as a whole, it's been very successful over the years, right? We have the legislative branch, we have the judicial branch, and we have the executive branch.
Yes, we do.
And so no one branch has too much control. And I think that's what's necessary also to protect our internet. The internet's borderless, it's distributed, control of it is distributed. So,
how vulnerable are we right now? What is our present threat level? Red, orange, green?
Well, I think it's a constant yellow.
Constant yellow.
Because we are suspect to attack right now, and it really depends on the direction and the choices made by the adversaries.
So the internet could be used not only for espionage but for outright warfare against the United States without any boots on the ground. Isn't that right?
That's correct. That's why I talk about it as being the equalizer. You can leverage the power of technology to get those workforce multipliers. So one individual, one group can impact a nation, an application equally.
Well, Don DeBolt, I have a question for you.
Sure.
Is the attack on Twitter something for us all to worry about?
It's certainly something else for us to be aware of. In this case, it appeared to be more of a political motivated attack. However, understanding that our nation, our corporations and individuals are becoming much more dependent on technology, much more dependent on the internet every day, and as a result, we're really showing how vulnerable we are, and our infrastructure is at this time, because a small faction can impact it, leveraging malware today.
We're vulnerable at this time. Don DeBolt, thank you so much for coming by.
Sure. Appreciate it.
And thank you for coming by. Tune in next week for more on the digital age. For the digital age, I'm Jim Zirin. Good night and all the best.